Hello, everybody, and welcome to the ESL One 2016 Manila main event. I'm Toby One. I'm here joined with the wonderful people who have brought hair revolution to the Dota 2 world, aka Capitalist and Blitz.
We are pretty awesome.
You are. You really are.
Thank you.
Shanghai Majors casters.
Yeah, grand final casters, obviously.
We're the best.
Yeah.
We just have Toby as like our third wheel.
Toby's
kind of used to it at this point.
I'm the old woman. I'm the chaperone to you two. Like, you guys go out, you go have your parties, and I make sure you end up with the nice people at the end of the day.
Is that how you justify it? You go out with a group of friends, and you're like the third person there. You're like, I'm making sure they don't have too much fun.
Yep, that's pretty much it, bro. I'm not allowed to have fun in my old age. I'm meant to be old and cranky.
I mean, Toby tries to phrase this in like some other way, but we all know the truth. Toby is on the decline, so he's trying to hop on the Cap and Blitz current hype train, trying to get in on that action. It's not going to happen, Toby. You can't share this.
Just dangle on the back of your coattails. That's all it really is. Well, speaking of someone else who knows how to jump on the back of a hype train, we've got the co-chair of Team Liquid to cast a Team Liquid game. It always works, maybe not so much. And they're going up against Mineski, the home crowd boys, the home advantage guys.
Which apparently we learned they're not too hype about. They feel like that's a bit of pressure, but I'm sure that Mineski will still show us something good. But this is obviously probably one of the more heavier, like, one-sided matches that, at least on paper, that we're looking at. Mineski, obviously, they haven't been, like, the same kind of dominant team at the C region as, say, Fnatic has. Mineski has had some up-and-down results, while obviously Team Liquid, coming fresh off of the Shanghai Major, was obviously, like, if you want to look at, like, team stock, say, they obviously raised their stock the highest off of that and are the most proven team in the current outset after both Secret and EG changed their rosters. So
I think Liquid right now, they come in with a lot to prove as well. Like Reserve you said, time. They're one of the teams that didn't swap the rosters at all. It's really typical to have a really good result at a major event and then kind of slack off, but this is definitely an event that they're going to want to prove themselves in. Mineski, they've got the home crowd advantage. They didn't have to travel very far. They get to kind of just relax, and there's not a whole lot of pressure on them. They've got the hometown crowd behind them. You know, they've got to feel at least okay about that. Most importantly, there's just not a lot of pressure on them. The last time we saw them was at the Frankfurt Major, and they did pretty well there. Like, in the group stage, I think they got first. In the group or post-group play, they had to play against a lot of hard teams. Like, I think they ran into OG and somebody else really strong, but they looked okay. And what I expect here out of them is maybe they pull off something a little bit risky. So far, they've done well for themselves in the draft. I think they took out two heroes that Liquid would have liked to have nabbed for themselves, while also picking two strong heroes for themselves.
Radiant team pick.
Witch Doctor for Team Liquid, I think it's probably one of the best supports to zone out the Nature's Prophet, because you have a Bounty Hunter, you know he's going to be roaming around quite a bit, putting pressure on the mid lane, so you need a really strong support to match up against that Nature's Prophet, and it's probably one of the best. But we were kind of talking about before this event, leading into it, how like teams like Mineski would have to do something like really different to throw off teams, because they're... Like, if you look at just some of their current C qualifier stuff, like, it's not Radiant actually that off the wall that it's going to throw a team like Liquid off. So maybe this Lich pick is something, you know, different that we're anticipating. Maybe they don't feel confident about their mid matchup, but we'll see some sort of, like, dual lane mid scenario against the OD. That actually could be the best way at this point to deal with the OD, seeing as... many of the better heroes to deal with it have already been banned away. Beastmaster and Doom, I would say, were some of the best non-mid lane heroes to be able to deal with an OD mid lane. He's a bit of a glass cannon hero, so you want to try and target him, focus him down pretty quickly on the onset of a team fight.
I think picking Alk here is a little bit strange. Maybe they plan on doing dual lanes, like Lich Alk mid or something against the OD, but I think OD still survives against that. And most importantly, Liquid are going to punish pretty hard the type of lineup that they have. This is a really mobile lineup that probably goes better once the Lone Druid gets Radiance. this game becomes really hard for Mineski to fight directly into them.
Reserve
and we know
time.
The Lone Druid's going to have a really good time in his lane because of the fact that we're anticipating Lich to be a dual lane, some sort of dual lane scenario, most likely mid. So we know the other support is going to be Tusk. That's a melee support facing up against a Lone Druid. I mean, most of the time, just regular dual lanes, like most normal dual lanes are not going to be that good at shutting out a Lone Druid unless it's some sort of really aggressive, like good kill lineup. But we already know, like, Tusk plus whatever is unlikely to really be able to shut out that hero that well. Yeah. Unless
Radiant
they pick up, like, some sort of ranged, almost like tempo hero that comes online really quickly and has good kill potential. I just can't think of what that is that would go with the Tusk.
I think for Mineski, they needed something that would win the lane. I think that's why the Queen of Pain pick is, or Ban. Was pretty good, because you can put her against the Lone Druid, she can at least survive, but it depends too, because Liquid have been known to put their Lone Druid in both the safe lane and the off lane. They can mind control and Matama Man can switch off.
Team Isn't this just a little concerning though with the Mineski lineup, that everything's a little too defensive if Liquid just want to like slowly farm up their own jungle, even if they need to rotate someone into that? Isn't that just a little too easy for Liquid to do? Hey, Mineski can't contest.
I think the biggest thing is that Liquid can just run at Mineski right now. The one advantage that Mineski have that I was looking at too is Liquid does lack a little bit in the hard disabled department or when it comes to these big team fight abilities. I know a lot of people are going to point to the death ward, but I don't think this is a spell that has reliable damage. You can't just expect your Witch Doctor to go into a fight and get his ultimate off during the entire duration. And he's not going to have a lot of farm because Bounty's going to not be buying a lot. He's going to be playing mainly for himself. The OD ultimate, pretty long cooldown, low druid and track, not really team fight ability, but...
So I think Mineski did have the right idea, which was they could run the safe lane lone druid and then pick up a nice initiating disabler in Batrider that comes online relatively early that synergizes with certain single target heroes like the OD or pulling it into the Witch Doctor Death Ward. I think that was the best idea that Liquid could have essentially shored up that small weakness that we see in their draft.
Yeah, I'm trying to think right now if there's like one more ban.
I mean, Liquid is definitely not a void team, so that's definitely out the window.
I think it's okay here, though. When you have,
I think it's okay, but
you have OD Witch Doctor on your team. I think it's all right, actually.
Yeah, I think it's all right, but I'm saying I just don't see Liquid picking it. Right? They're not really a void team.
I think when you run OD and Witch Doctor, there's still a decent case for it, though.
Okay.
It's not your first option, but
yeah.
Hey, you're all right though. They go for the Tidehunter instead. Pick. I know on Dire side too, they don't like it as much. Like if this were Radiant and they had this lineup, then they probably would have gone for Void. Oh, that's okay.
The mid Jakiro Lich.
We were talking about this. What I wanted to point out when they did the last pick, Batrider, is because what Swindle said, right, is what you do to beat heroes like OD, and I remember this all the time now because it was a really good point, is that you mess with his attack animation, or you just make sure that, because he doesn't really have independent nukes. Like, he relies really heavily on just bursting heroes down with his Arcane Orb. So when you can get rid of that and slow down his attack speed with things like the Liquid Fire, you're in a much better position.
So we've seen things like Mid Enchantress be run before. The Batrider is obviously like one of the best heroes you could possibly have against the OD. But when it comes to mid lane matchups, the Jakiro is something that we have seen experimented with against the OD, and it hasn't really gone that well. I have been like pretty adamant that I just don't think that this is. Like, obviously some teams have run it in scrims and it seems to work out, but every single time I've seen it in an official, it just is not effective enough. It can kind of slow down something, it can get some little mid-game momentum, but it's just not enough.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of that early game momentum as well, just pushing into towers, but we'll have ourselves a quick pause. Just before we do kick into the game, I want to say big apologies out there to everyone. We're going to get the Dota TV audios fixed as fast as possible, but there's no Dota TV audio for game number one, but we will be here with our live stream hopefully going out absolutely smoothly. So we have a pause, so we can quickly check out where everything's going to go. So you boys seem to be pretty much locked in to Jakiro Lich mid?
No.
It looks like the Jakiro's safe lane.
So you're gonna if Jakiro's running safe lane, does this almost bring it back to like BZZ style?
I don't know. I'm trying to think right now what the best thing for Mineski is, just because they have this core Jakiro, and that hero is really inflexible. You just it's not really mobile. It's not going to gank a whole lot. You kind of just have to stick this guy in a lane and hope that it works out.
Well, then you still got to look towards like some kind of win condition, right? Like if you got Jakira this early on, is it early Liquid fire and just force down buildings, force Liquid to fight into you? But yeah. You also said early in the drafting phase that Liquid are stronger because they can just walk straight at him.
Part of the problem would be is why we're kind of thinking about Lich Alchemist as our dual lane mid, right? I think like Jakiro Lich, some sort of like weird Jakiro Lich, that would be all in on shutting down the OD mid, right? But that would leave you extremely exposed in that bottom lane against the Tidehunter because you'd have double melee heroes, right? You would have Alchemist Tusk or something like that bottom lane, and that just wouldn't be good enough. So if you split this up, you put the Jakiro then against the Tidehunter, that you're still able to put some pressure on that Tide. Still able to keep that in control. Well, the Lich is the partner here with the Alchemist, is just still going to be able to keep the OD's farm relatively in check via those denies and maybe some nice harassment.
Yeah, in some ways I agree with you a lot too about the Jakiro pick being a little bit weird, because when I do see this hero, it feels a little bit all-in-ish to me, like you said. I think for Liquid, the game plan is pretty simple. You weather the storm, you try to get BKBs up on your OD, try to get the Radiance up on the Lone Druid, and they've got a really good high ground hero to accomplish that. That's why heroes like Tidehunter and Void, I would have been okay with either, because the Void breaks BKB, and the Tide can just kind of fight. It's really scary pushing up high ground against a Tidehunter, right? But Mind Control might actually pay for...
Yeah, he's dropping really low.
Yeah, that is going to be first blood. That was like really obvious when Mineski started showing forward that Tidehunter was going to die, because the Tusk is such a great level one hero in those kind of scenarios. The block out of Ice Shards, it's decent damage. It's like a really good soft disable. So that was like guaranteed first blood.
They did mess with one thing though. The fact that with that distraction, Ben-Hur actually moved off the rune. So yeah. Kuro actually stole the bounty rune from him.
He didn't even move off of it. He like sat there. He was like, I'm getting this rune. But Kuro just clicked faster.
Matoma Man though, he's going to have a pretty decent matchup, especially with the Witch Doctor support on his side, as Jerax just fighting off the Treants, one of the few support heroes that can actually do so, as the Treants are quite strong at level 1 against the supports, and pace of the game should definitely go to Mineski. Like, they have to push this pace. We talked about how Liquid, they should do fine, especially in this mid lane.
It seems a little odd, though, the fact that Varsh has also not gone for Sacrifice, because he went for Frostblast to start with.
It was the level 1 fight at hand. They wanted that first blood, yep. So it's, again, the sacrifice you have to make sometimes. Crows, this bounty hunter pick is really working out well for them, because part of this Lich dual lane mid scenario was him denying creeps away from the OD, but also stacking.
They're already going to have a crack at Ben-Hur. That Orb of Venom doing some work. He's going to actually fairy fire up, but it's still not enough. Kuro gets just barely enough damage to get the kill before he reaches the tier 1 tower.
Yeah, and this is going to help this mid matchup so much, because Mineski, they wanted to try to slow down this OD with this dual lane, but hasn't been successful so far, and even at this top lane, the Nature's Prophet is doing an okay job of trying to contest, but again, he's against a pretty difficult lane.
You can never push out that far against a bounty hunter like that, especially as a melee hero. Yeah. It just leaves you too exposed. Even if he lived there, it still would have been pretty crippling for him to lose that much of his regen.
They're going to get both the runes too for Liquid. And this is the downside of going for these kinds of dual lanes, is because Mind Control knows that he can't get shoved off this bottom lane. And most importantly, Kuro can kind of just do whatever he wants in regards to movement. He's even going to set up for this regen rune at top for Fada as a result. And oftentimes, if you're Mineski, you want to try to deny these, but because of the dual lane, don't really have a lot of options.
When you're running around with a smoke this early on the Lich, are you just buying this thing just so you can make sure you got more of him later into the game? Or should Varsh be looking to rotate and do something as this Lich?
You're putting it on cooldown.
I don't think there's any reason for him to rotate right now.
Liquid really forcing that top lane with the paralyzing cast. They're getting pretty close. The resummon of the bear to try and find another hit. And as one more from the bear would do the work. Matubman's come in very, very deep. They find the kill, but there's no rotation from Mineski to really punish him. Matubman should just be able to safely walk himself out of here.
Yeah, you see the mass pings, but this is the downside of your kind of like dual lane scenario. If anything, the Tusk should have a TP in this.
Oh, they're going to go bottom lane. Mind Control, the Shards actually blocking him in with the Dual Breath and Liquid Fire. Mind Control, he is ticking down pretty quickly. Have they got enough damage to finish the job? They're coming in very deep underneath the tower, but no Dual Breath, no Liquid Fire. Looks like Reggie Potato really wanted to keep going for that one, but Jules pulls out. So they have to accept the fact they're not going to find the kill, but they do force Mind Control all the way back to base.
It's just not being effective enough, I would say, in comparison to...
They're going again on mid. Ben-Hur being attacked up. There's no Astral Imprisonment early leveled up. In fact, it's just a 2-0-2, and that's giving Fada just enough damage to get the kill before reaching deep into the safety. And he's not even going down the stairwell. Like, when the sentry ward's down, he just doesn't see anything.
Yeah, right now this is really scary for him in this matchup. I'm not sure what you're supposed to do, though, as an Alp cap.
I think he's playing a little bit too far forward in lane, but their game plan was just off from the beginning due to the fact they didn't have Sacrifice, so they couldn't keep that lane back like they wanted to, and that's part of the downside of spamming out Acid Spray, right, is that it is naturally going to push the lane forward. I think he's just getting a bit too greedy. He has to remember, Ben-Hur has to remember that he has the fallback, he has the neutrals that he's going to be able to farm later. It's important for him just to not feed the OD, and also the Bounty Hunter. Like, you're giving the Bounty Hunter free levels at this point, where
wow,
he should
potato.
Be just zapping.
You're in so deep, that Dual Breath very much off target, so Mind Control will freely walk down, Jurex will TP in, and Kuro already started the rotation with the early point up in Maledict. They're going to be able to lock in Raging Potato, the shards from Jules trying to actually create a little bit more space with a Shuriken Toss. Now they also bring in more help with the Paralyzing Cast from Jurex. They're able to reach out and find the kill, allowing their Mind Control to gush over onto Boccarino. They're going to snowball over, picking up the Nature's Prophet, but there is no real way to get out of this one alive. They just try and bring Jurex down with him instead, almost able to achieve that task, getting blocked up by the Treants himself. Jules couldn't reach over to Jurex, who'll hide in the tree lines. These Treants are still looking for their opening target. The Jules, he's ticking down, he'll very fire up. Now he actually sees Jurex. Is he snowballed to him? No, he snowballed over to Kuro instead, and now allow the last to attack to come in from the Bounty Hunter, finding himself a kill. With the Dustle up, Kuro is still visible, then he will burn out now to this Jakiro underneath that side shop. Mind Control should be able to just retreat himself out of this one as well, unless he wants to continue the fight.
He doesn't know it, but Jurex is still there. He's a free kill, essentially, if Raging Potato just went for it.
Oh, he's going to wait for the creep wave to skip past first and then run past, and that's why he places that ward down there. It's just free entrance for him, and they're pinging like crazy. And
there's already an Obs ward that sees him.
Yeah, I think the Nature's Prophet right now is really... It feels like he's tilted, because he's just pinging everywhere. He's like, guys, we have to do something, and Jurex is going to go down to the neutral creeps. But a point I wanted to bring up that Cap made earlier, too, is when you've got this Alchemist, a lot of the times he's going to be playing around this mid lane. When the Lich goes to stack the camps, he has to play back. Otherwise, he's just presenting a free target for himself. And Liquid, they're timing their ganks around that moment, when they know for a fact that the Lich went to go stack the hard camp. If they just look up at the timer, they say, okay, he's going to be gone for this 20-second period. Let's take advantage of this.
Looks like Manessi are going to try and force onto this tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. Mind Control and Kuro are the two here to defend it, and again, they're going to bring in Jurex to also help out. But with that Liquid Fire and Dual Breath, they take a lot of damage just staying in close, but now maybe they do actually find the kill over on Raging Potato. The shards are pushing back out a little bit further. One more Liquid Fire will ensure the kill on the tower. Jurex is going to time it perfectly to get the denial off, and this will actually mean that while the tier 1 tower does go down, it is denied and you lose your safe laner. And Fada actually find himself a haste rune, so chasing in Jules. Jules actually just stops walking for a moment to pick up a TP scroll, and now he's also down for the count.
I mean, that was a moment where like Jakiro knew he like started running back and he realized, I'm not getting out of here alive. So he goes deeper and tries to go for that tier 1 tower, and he still doesn't even get that much. Liquid are denying everything that Manesky are trying to trade themselves for, and they're coming up big in this laning phase.
I think the most important thing to note too is that when you run this roaming support around, this is the benefit, is that he can rotate to this soft lane and help out and just slow down the tower pushes and make them even more dangerous.
They're going mid. Sentries are down, won't really matter. You can see Kuro coming, the result will still be the same. Alchemist, even with his chemical rage, that's gonna be a death.
I like this choice as well as the Maledict here from Jurex. Just one level. It helps put pressure on the Furion, but it's even bigger against some of these tankier heroes like the Alchemist. So it's just a nice offensive pickup, because that's also why like Kuro is able to roam around, but so is Jurex, and that's because of the success of the safe lane that they had against Boccarino. The way that they were able to pick up that early kill and control those Treants to make sure he didn't really get good pulls off as a Furion or anything. Because of the lack of success there, they were able to then move their supports around a lot more.
Kuro saw the farming of the stack, so he's going to come in here and leech a little bit of this experience out.
He's probably going to get 6 off of this.
But he's already managed to find level 5 just off his earlier rotation, so yep. But they're splitting this 3 ways right now. And okay, no, Liquid are not going to stand for it. There's still a heavy amount of those creeps left. So Ben-Hur, he's going to back up. This time he's playing defensively, and Jurex and Kuro won't have their opportunity.
Yeah, all the while, by the way, we haven't even talked about the fact that Matumba Man is steadily just farming at this top lane. Hasn't really been contested at all because of the pressure that they've been putting on the bottom lane. And Mineski, it just feels like they're losing a little bit of focus. When they made that bottom play, Liquid, they used a lot of TPs for that. So they know that the only way that Liquid comes back in is through that mid lane. There's no pressure that's going to be exerted on that top lane. So Mineski had to be a little bit more careful about their positioning, especially with the Alchemist again being way too far forward and just getting picked off. But sort of think this is their time to reset a little bit. The downside though is that you've got a Jakiro, which isn't one of those fallback heroes that you're really excited to have when the pace of the game slows down. And so I still think it's on Mineski to kind of just get going.
They're going to try to have a crack over here. Koro with the dust going off. Koro just instantly TP's out. There's no ice path leveled up. No. This is Ragey Potato going for a pure lane dominance build with a Liquid Fire and Dual Breath.
This is the right build for the Koro Jakiro, but it does leave you woefully exposed.
Now Liquid now, actually, they stare down their own target. Can they get over for this one? Matumman's actually rotating into the mid with the Dire Observer Ward. They're going to see that Courier making his play out.
They're going to sandwich him here.
Straight on top of the Lich. With this kill, should have enough space now. They can also just attack into the Tier 1 tower and clean out any of these close camps as well, which the Alchemist may have been hoping to farm up later on.
Other teams like might have used this sort of opportunity of the supports and offlane kind of dominating to just leave Matumba Man in that top lane and safe lane farm away, but Liquid are usually prioritized taking the map control as fast as they can. And Tier 1 tower, Radiant side, it's like one of the most important towers in the game. So Liquid see this opportunity to cut from top lane into mid, sandwich the tower, and if they can't get the tower, it's because Mineski have full rotated heroes in. And that just leaves the side lanes open then at that point.
Yeah. It is the right move though for Mineski. I don't think you can ever give up this tier 1 tower this early. It leaves too much space in the jungle for Liquid to kind of play around with. Especially if they go for the Dire, or for the Radiant tier 1 tower at bottom too. Then it opens up Roshan as well. I think if you're Mineski though, this is kind of just in a rough spot. Like they kind of have to push the pace right now. They're waiting for some items, but there's no item on their team that really allows for them to get some kind of crazy spike. Maybe the Alchemist goes for the Armlet and then you get the drums, the Yules on the Jakiro, but none of those items are that exciting.
Yeah, you could say that like the old safe lane Jakiro, the Yules is like maybe a little bit significant, but with the new Yules that doesn't have the same kind of range of initiation, it doesn't even allow you to be able to get like a long range pick off into the ice path. It's just not the same.
Yeah.
So I think Blitz is entirely right that Mineski just have to go for it. They can't wait for items. You don't pick a Jakiro for the items that he's going to farm up. You pick it up because of his skill set. He's a tanky, good damage over time hero that pushes down towers. You got to start five-manning him.
Well, you got one of your items. I guess the only one which you mentioned which could be picked up this early on. So the Armlet will now be over on the Alchemist. He's still really low on the levels. So far away from having that level 2 Chemical Rage. Meanwhile, Liquid is getting so much space to also keep their farm going. We've got to keep our eyes on Matumbaman, now sitting at 2.4k gold, so that relic is coming in soon. Not to mention just his net worth difference. Right now he's a full 2,000 in front of the Jakiro.
Hey, I guess the biggest difference there though is just you've got a Midas Lone Druid who's had infinite space, whereas the Jakiro's been repeatedly TP'd on, but Liquid are going to be comfortable with the pace of the game right now. It's been slowed down dramatically. Going for the mid-tier 1 tower I think was the right idea, but don't necessarily have to all-in commit for it, just because their lineup is not contingent on taking these early towers. Even with that, with the fact that they have only taken that top tower, they're still 5k ahead, and they haven't really even gotten the track kills to go yet. I kind of agree with Kev, like, yeah, Mineski have to go for it, but they probably want to at least wait for all of these side items. Like, why go for the fight when you're 200 gold away from the Yules, or when you're barely just about to pick up the Armlet? I think now that you've got the Armlet, you've got the drums and the Nature's Prophet, this is the time to go. Because the next wave of items is going to take way too long for Mineski. I think you just lose map control against a Bounty Hunter.
Unfortunately, it just came a bit too late for them to be able to save that Radiant Tier 1 tower. The damage had already been kind of done by Liquid with that earlier movement to mid. Maybe they didn't fully commit to take it, and that was the right play by them. But they still did enough damage that Blitzhelm event just casually cleans it up.
Dubman also casually just zoning out Vash from the mid lane. But by doing this, he's actually forced Lich back behind the lane, and it looks like Liquid are going to go for a 13-minute Roshan. He's still got the TP up to the top lane by Mind Control, try and push Raging Potato off this Tier 1 tower, so they don't have to go for a direct trade. Actually, Macropike in middle as well. Mind Control, take a little bit of burn. But Fada and Kuro are going to try and finish up Roshan while this defense continues.
This should tip them off, though. The fact that nobody's come to this top lane. even when he was being dove into the tower by the Tiro. This is a really a mobile hero. The fact that they just kind of let that Tiro go, the tower go down. That's good signal.
That's a second tier 1 tower they've taken, and both of them have been denied. He even tried to use his ice path to buy that small little space for the liquid fire to tick through it, but it just didn't work.
The supports just weren't in the right position. They had to be backing the Jakiro up there. They needed to be able to force an initiation if Liquid did some sort of like half contest at that top lane. Because, you know, the Alchemist needs to run away. But
Ocarino.
Yep, the Mash should catch him out. Quick kill, burns a drum charge as well, and with no Nature's Prophet, he was actually starting his TP up to top lane. It looked like Mineski were ready to attack, even though Team Liquid had the Aegis the Immortal. They're preparing to attack into that tier 2 tower, and well, they're not going to be dissuaded. Major Potato is still going to get a couple hits off with this liquid fire and do as much as he can.
Yeah, this OD's just looking around right now to see if he has any opportunities, but Mineski, they want to dodge the fight wherever they can. They're trying to drag Liquid back up here and get them to play on their terms. The benefit of having that Nature's Prophet is normally he can push out that bottom lane and they can apply pressure in two spots on the map at once and maybe even get control of Liquid's jungle, but Liquid catching out the Nature's Prophet is going to stop this a little bit, and this top tier 2 tower, they've got to make the decision to go for it right now.
Yep, are they going to? Treants it down, but Paralyzing Cask and Anchor Smash. They made the decision to go, and now they're actually bailing out. With the Prophet TPing top, they force at least the movement from Liquid. But now it leaves Raging Potato on the bottom lane.
Yeah, that's what I meant, by the way, that Mineski should just, or Liquid should go, because you shouldn't let this tower tick down so much. But by showing on this top side of the map, it's going to allow Raging Potato to take some space here at bottom. The problem, though, Toby, is I don't really know what this does. Like,
what does Jiro do with space?
Yeah, it's
all right, guys, time to find the next item.
Build that veil.
If that were like an Ember, I'd be like, that's fantastic. They just created two spots on the map, but at bottom, he's just going to get gone on by the OD.
He's going to run into the tree lines, but he can't make the Fog of War in time, and Metabomas now arrived with that fresh radiance on his bear. So Raging Potato into the trees, no TP for 23 seconds, and no friends coming to help him out either. So he'll end up going down. He'll Ice Path once more, at least catching out three, but the orb attacks just do so much work, and you're going to lose your Tuskar in the top river. He snowballed to buy a little bit of time, but Jules will also take the fall. We're 2-13 on the board. Team Liquid looking amazing, and they're looking to actually push even further with Trax now kicking in. All these kills are working so much better for Team Liquid, and even the long-range Paralyzing Cask, luckily for Vash, it won't bounce to him, but Fada just triggers Drum Charge. He's got himself an Aegis the Immortal, so he blinks aggressively in. That ulti brings Vash to 10 HP, which is barely not enough to find the kill. But that at least sends a very strong message to Mineski.
Mineski don't even look like a five-man team right now. They really don't. With the like the fact that Jakiro was being gone on for a lengthy amount of time in bottom lane, and that they also had someone getting picked off in mid, and I was watching the minimap and just watching the heroes, like, nobody was responding. Like, if they're going in that bottom lane scenario, then Mineski should in turn be committing to mid and trying to, like, force that fight or something, knowing, hey, two cores are bottom lane, let's force that. But they weren't even trying. It was just like, well, you guys are both caught. Oh well, we're just going to keep farming jungle.
Mineski also just smoked under an Observer Ward just to add insult to injury at the moment. And what do they even go for? Like, killing off the bear is almost an impossible task at the moment, but Kuro coming in very close. The smoke isn't going to break, but yeah, when you're tracked up, now the drum charge triggers. Fada's going to come in from the side, and who's his primary target? He just goes on top of the Lich. You've already lost an Aegis Prophet further down south as Kuro keeps his tracks in. Is there an entangle? Tuskar still keeps the run going. Now that Lich Ulti is going to start bouncing around. Kuro can be careful. He's going to drop low. But then the creep wave just starts to soak up more. But it's Raging Potato who finally gets something back. Slipping in through the rear. He may not be able to survive this. He liquid fires. Doesn't have dual breath. He macro fires as much damage as he can find on top of Fada, who doesn't care. Remember, he's still got the Aegis the Immortal. So Raging Potato, your number one position. He'll burn an Aegis the Immortal, and the cost of it is his life. While Matomaman is just on objective-based gaming. Tier 2 tower belongs to him.
Two things I really want to point out about this game that, for me anyways, usually signifies how a game is going is, one, if the threat of the Tidehunter ultimate alone makes you dodge every single fight, the fact that he hasn't casted it, like, I haven't seen him cast it, that usually means that your team is just, like, not interested. They know that they're that far behind, that they don't even want to risk that. But Liquid are just playing off of that because they know that they don't want a team fight. They don't want to get into a full five-man engagement. So the Tide just continues to farm during this time period. And this is the correct response by him, too. Secondly, I mean, Liquid just have all the space in the world. They've taken control of this bottom tier, tier 2 area. They've got the jungle unlocked. Fada's just doing whatever he wants in this game. And Liquid aren't even really playing so much as a team as they are just kind of hunting.
Yeah. To add on to Blitz's first point, the reason that, like, there are some scenarios where, like, just dodging the Tidehunter and stuff is, like, obviously the right play, but it oftentimes means you have better late game. But in this sort of scenario, we're anticipating that this kind of strategy is going to be trying to fight Liquid, and yet, you know, 12 minutes in, they were scared of a Tidehunter. That just tells you how bad the laning phase really went.
Yeah. Something I want to point out, too, is that what's naturally hard against playing against the Lone Druid is if you don't have immediate mech carriers against the Lone Druid Radiance, your team just can't survive. Like, everybody has like 1,000 HP on the side of Mineski. What are they supposed to do in these big team fights?
They found Kuro. This is at least the first break they're really going to get. Kuro was the only one to die previously. Looks like he's going to die again. Mr. Kuro will find that kill. He walked underneath the sentry wall but broke their smoke.
Oh, bottom. They might get something going.
Oh, yeah. Fada. There's your imprisonment, but he's locked inside the scrum. No way to cut himself free. Can't blink himself away. But Metopolis coming in and mind control. That ice path actually stops him from blinking forward to going into the Ravage, but now nothing stops him. He goes in. He's practically all of Mineski apart from Ben-Hur, who has to turn around for this concoction. He's waiting the longest amount of time to do it. But unfortunately, he's just lost his teammate while it happens. Mind control and anchor smash, and now this alchemist does minimal to no damage. The shards will keep Liquid here, but at the same time, I don't think Mineski, that's a real big advantage for them.
Certainly not. Liquid aren't really scared of being trapped next to the Mineski base too much at this point. They own every part of the map except for the high ground.
Has Kuro really got that much money? is he going for a scythe, or is this...
I mean, Kuro can go whatever the hell he wants. When you're this far ahead, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, that's a 6-3-7 bounty hunter who just casually has a mystic staff. There's no way that's even item efficient. He's probably just like, whatever. He can go for the ultimate orb, but...
And in a normal game, what would you say? Like, because you have a mech carrier on the Tide, what would you say? Like, Lotus Orb or something, if it's the right kind of game for it?
I think Lotus Orb has a lot of benefits. I think the Hex, if you could get it on a support 5 bounty hunter before 30 minutes, it makes so much impact. Just because you troll around invis, then you pop out with the Hex, no hero's going to be able to survive that. And at top, they know for a fact that there's no Tide Ravage and there's no OD ult. This might actually be the only time period where Mineski is going to be able to fight, but
their only issue is they're being pushed on all the other sidelines. That bottom town's at 7 HP. Like, Matumba just leaves it there, so he has to. So Mineski have to keep some level of player down here, or they deny the tower. Yeah, meanwhile, the tier 2. Okay, there's your imprisonment. They're going after the snowballed up Tusker and drag him back up to his own tier 2 tower. But Jules, with the ice path, hits by control. You get the X Smash off. That's a nice death wall from Jirax. He'll end up going down thanks to the Lich Ultimate. A Raging Potato on the run out of here. A Yulset will save him from that one last orb that came out from Fada. But Fada splinks forward. You can't escape. This team is just so good on positioning. And Metubman has now finished off the bottom racks practically by himself, while the rest of Mineski were distracted on the top lane.
I sort of think Mineski should have just all-in for that top fight. They knew there was no Ravage, there's no OD ultimate, there's no Aegis, the Lone Druid isn't even there. If you can't win at that point, then you're not really fighting to stay in this game anymore. And they lost their bottom racks, they lost that top fight, which was really huge for them. And
It's a Shiva's and an Assault Cuirass.
Okay, so they're just going for the...
ultimate, you know, armor increases that allows them to have sustain to push high ground and end this game.
They've got Vlads too. I don't think I've seen Vlads, a Shiva's bounty hunter before.
Especially as your first major item, Fada. Playing around with Boccarino, throws the ulti down. The one shots will keep him alive, and Jules, well, will be the sacrificial lamb as Jakiro tried to run in, gets entangled. The Ravage will hit, and this may be the final nail in the coffin here for Mineski. They've lost so much, and they're going to tap it out. Game number one of this best of three will be going the way of Team Liquid, taking just under 23 minutes. The damn Liquid, they are rolling in the dark.
We're really seeing the danger of these kind of lineups. The reason that we talk about Jakiro as being kind of an all-in hero, you can really see it here. Liquid just had to make sure that they did really well in the first 10 minutes of the game, and it was over. Like, it really was. Everything that we casted from then on out was just kind of like extremely low percentage of chance of Mineski maybe getting themselves back into the game, but it just wasn't going to happen. Their strategy was never meant to be this far behind. It was never meant to be a scenario where you had to commit two heroes to stop a Lone Druid from pushing.